institutional open access repositories in college education. A proposal for the role in open educational resources in Greece. Okay. So let's go.
Good morning to everyone. My name is Nikos Koutras. I currently work on my PhD in lifelong learning at the Ionian University. And I would like also to tell you my partners and colleagues. Next to me are Ileana Araka and Melissa Makridou. Ileana Isa, yes. And our information scientists, adjunct lecturers at Alexander Technological Educational Institution of Thessaloniki.
See, Nikos is chairing this session.
With this presentation, we attempt to highlight in our work to point out the role of institutional repositories in college education in Greece. This issue and all relevant concepts are approached supranationally as Greece forms part of the European Union and conforms to European Union respective regulations. Many services and tools have been developed on top of e-learning. The issue of open educational resources has put on the map. The topic is approached supranationally, as I said, and specifically in relation to European projects such as C-Europe, e-learning and MOLCOS. It is quite clear that there is an increasing interest for the creation of open access repositories at the national and transnational level through European programs and cooperation initiatives. The future of information lies mainly upon the correct use of technological developments. However, there seems to be a certain amount of reluctance on the part of universities concerning the use of open access information and digital repositories. Despite that fact, there seems to be an increasing intention to create and properly manage open access repositories in Greece, attested by the increasing amount of recently founded Greek digital repositories. In this transparency, you can easily see the program's action plans initiatives that the European Committee launched in order to create a wide and well-known information society. Generally, some of the objectives, in other words, goals for the aforementioned supranationally move because energies, acts, could be seen in the following transparency, such as Internet Connectivity and Legal Framework, for example, for Europe 2002, Federal Electronic Services for Europe 2005, e-health, e-government, e-learning, e-business, promotion of digital literacy on European virtual campuses for the e-learning initiative, and innovation and investments, the I2007 initiative. That is why we can easily have some first thoughts. New information and communication technologies deeply affect the ways in which we obtain information, communicate and learn. These technologies entail challenges for the industry which uses and produces them. Employment, new professions and professional skills, culture with the development of new internet services that affect cultural habits and are considered to be either a threat or a chance to achieve cultural and social diversity. And education and training, multi-faced and touch upon different parts of society. We can easily understand and agree that education can be found at the heart of innovation in European Union decisions, demonstrating the significance of this field for the implementation of information and computer technologies. Actually, it seems that the concept of education has become a pillar for information
Many institutions have been changing the course of education towards a more open model of accessing educational information. Looking profoundly into today's education, we will present three key concepts: open educational resources, access, and institutional repositories. In brief, I will say some words of what an open educational resource is, what open access is, and what an institutional repository is. According to Maiden, a scholar working at GIST in UK, there is no need for an institution to create open educational resources if they can't be shared. In brief, an open educational resource means that access to open educational content, including metadata, is provided free of charge, that this content is liberally licensed for reuse in educational activities, that open source software and open APIs are used. One could easily assume the relation of open access to open educational resources. Open access, as the Greek National Documentation Center defines it, is the open, direct, common, and free of charge and most of the legal intellectual property limitations internet access to digital academic and scientific content. Users can use freely the available material for educational and other purposes. But anyway, this, the thing I put here, we put here the common principle, I think we opened the wrong transparencies, the wrong kind of transparencies. Anyway, I would say, the principle underlying both terms is summed up to the following statement, but the thing is that in Greek it says, because it's supposed to appear in the transparency. In Greek this principle says that content should be free and open access by all people that can be profit by it. That's the principle. And you can see here in the figure that IRs contain educational material and that is of open access. That's why educational resources and access are connected up at the circles of binding. In order for those materials to be accessed openly, it's first of all that they are only devices that can support efficiently not only free access, but search and indexing functions, metadata administration and preservation, and intellectual property rights management mechanisms, as well as established policies upon which all mentioned above can rely and function properly for the benefit of the end user. Institutional repositories could play this role as they bring together all these supporting mechanisms. A good example where open educational resources can be found is the Open Learn repository of the UK Open University. It was founded in October 2006. It is part of the Open Educational Resources Project. Its aim is to provide free access to all Open University educational material throughout the world. It uses an attribution share-alike non-commercial license of Creative Commons. It is a movie-based virtual learning environment, and it is divided in two areas, the learning space and the lab space. The learning space area is enriched by learning and communicational tools area that supports the use of forums, instant messaging, video conferencing and blogging, tagging or labeling of content, the creation of personal profiles, the creation of the visual representation of the resources, and many more. Lab space allows all users to contribute and share their own educational material. Open2.net is the online learning portal from the BBC and the UK Open University, where the latter broadcasts, giving access to a variety of topical and interactive content, even to educational videos and games. All users can follow OpenLearn on Twitter, or find it on YouTube channels, Facebook and iTunes U, iTunes University. It is worth mentioning the feedback that users leave on some of the above social media, expressing the usefulness of OpenLearn. So these social technologies, Web2 technologies, or other related social applications, along with OpenLearn's licensing model, encourage replication of content and enable interoperability with other providers' content management systems. This way, viral content is created and is accessible for remote communities around the world. Viewing many European examples concerning open educational resources and presenting just before OpenLearn, we wanted to study the current situation of educational resources in Greece, so we conducted a descriptive study that aimed at identifying the amount and type of educational resources, the types of software platform used, and matters regarding metadata and intellectual property rights licenses. 38 colleges were examined in total, and we found 18,527 was the total amount of courses. The courses are divided into three categories: open, locked, and courses that require registration. Open courses are those that permit access to internal users, that is, student or college staff, professors, administrative staff, etc., and external, which is every internet user. Locked courses are the courses whose content is visible only to registered students under permission granted by the professor, and courses that require registration permit access to registered internal or external users. So here we see a pie with the percentages of the total amount of courses. We see that the blue, 47% of the total amount of courses studied were open courses. And we see also the lowest percentage, which is 90%, that refers to locked courses. Of course, the remaining one is the courses that were studied. Here we see the software type that most colleges prefer to use. Mostly they prefer to use VLEs, virtual learning environments. And here, please pay attention to the second row, OpenEClass, which has the highest percentage. So colleges, among others, prefer to use OpenEClass. And we have a percentage of 63.2%. And the second comes Moodle, two lines under, which has 18.4%.
No.
We concluded that we can talk in Greece about educational resources and not open educational resources because there is no sharing at all. So we have open access to educational material, but we cannot share educational material. We found an extended use of open software. Mainly colleges prefer to use virtual learning environments. Those virtual learning environments do not use metadata and no kind of metadata, and the few repositories that host that host educational resources use Dublin Core. We found no Creative Commons or other types of licenses, and concerning open educational resources in general, it's called lack of common central policy and a clear legal framework. So we recommend that the legal framework should change in favor of institutional repositories, as we believe, as we said earlier, that repositories are a good place to host open educational resources. The legislation of open learning repositories could be done by two ways. The first is by adding a new paragraph to Law 3369 of 2005, which concerns the systematic lifelong learning. In Article 2 of this law, that lists the organizations that promote lifelong learning, colleges are included there, it could be useful to get a new paragraph added legislating the open learning repositories. This would give a separate substance to repositories, recognizing them as providers of information services. Funding and policy development would be easier, and free information, the quality of free information would be assured. Alternatively, by adding an article to Chapter 2 of the same law within the section Other Provisions, this option offers the possibility of a mild adjustment to this law and thus to the attempt of quality assurance of information, as it was mentioned already. This way, a key institutional framework for the existence of repositories and their nationwide operation under common rules could be achieved. provided the legal framework is regulated, a series of open educational resources related tasks should be set out. This should be human-centered and could include, among others, the enhancement of open educational resources, the use of tools and services that promote collaborative learning, user-friendly design interfaces that allow easy access to resource and resource search, enforcement of open content initiatives, engagement of teachers and learners in the development of learning tools, clarification of intellectual property rights, and determination of the way Creative Commons license is acquired, and many more. Further to be discussed is the operational program with the title Educational and Lifelong Learning and the repository journal. Currently, the operational program Educational and Lifelong Learning is taking place in Greece. Through this program, interested colleges are invited to lay down proposals about the creation of open educational resources. This program will be completed by the end of 2014, so for the years to come, changes in education are expected and new data are to come up for research. As for the results of this program, the operational program, it could be further discussed the idea of an online space where instructors all over Greece and or internationally could interchange opinions and share their educational material. A good example of how this could be done is the Jorum repository. You can visit it in the URL we provide here. It's a service that collects and enables the sharing of learning and teaching materials, allowing their reuse and repurposing across the UK. JORM could form a good example for this, as it was designed with a DORA human-centered logic. And before closing this presentation and welcoming any questions you may have, we would like to share with you our opinion on freedom of information. We believe that openness of information should be viewed as social good, so spread the idea.
For this excellent presentation. Don't try, not go anywhere. We certainly have some questions, and coming from a lawyer who is specialized in copyright testing, that people speak like you, open education, share, give. How are you going to do that if you don't change the entire system of copyright? Wait. You talk about Creative Commons licenses. You have a sort of like, why do we use common license in repositories, Creative Commons? When you have a repository and you have, say, 10 articles from 10 journals, okay, these are copyrighted. Mm-hmm. So you put them in the repository?
No. You put in the repository only the articles that are permitted to be in a repository according to the publisher that
okay,
has the copyright.
And the part allows you to put in the repository. Yes.
Mm.
Okay. But then how are you going to share it the way you want to share it, to give it everywhere, if you don't change the system of the copyright? This is the question. Or if you don't do that, if you cannot take something that is under copyright and put in the repository, okay, it's a terrible percentage of journals that you're going to miss, that you cannot put in, because the publisher won't give you copyright. Okay. So how are you going to build a fantastic open repository if you don't attack the whole system of the copyright?
No, we have to attack the whole system of the copyright. But the thing is that we're not lawyers, so we have to collaborate with you in order to achieve it.
Okay, that's
great. So, I mean, as far as educational content is concerned, mm-hmm. I think we could use Creative Commons licenses mm-hmm. to build an open model for sharing and repurposing these kind of materials. I mean, if we talk about scholar material, it is more difficult. I can understand the example with the
scientific journals. Because the biggest percent of the journals are copyrighted, and they're never going to give you this kind of license that you want.
Yes, I
know. And this is the as to now, important material. The material that we have to cite, we have to be aware of that. So if you want to build a really good repository, you have to attack copyright.
Yes, that's
yeah?
true.
I mean, you do agree with
me. Yes, I do. Mm-hmm. But I believe also that our recommendations could be applied in educational, not wide educational material, in terms of what students read for a class, for example.
Mm-hmm.
Not the whole bibliography.
Okay, just a percentage. Yes,
a percentage. Mm-hmm. This could be done, I think, with the Creative Commons licenses with metadata. Mm-hmm. I think it could be done.
I just want to continue along the same lines. I suspect it's a generation problem. The old guys think that things have to go differently. I teach at the ACP, the University of Utah Anatolia College here, and I've had stuff online for my students for 15 years or something like that. It's always been closed.
To the students?
Closed to the outside.
Yeah.
Right? So it's available to
only students. For the students.
I used to have an internet password, now we have Blackboard, now we have Moodle. It's basically the same system, it's locked. Now, I just want to explain to you why do I do that. That's all these one business one Maria mentioned. Of course, an important part of the class is reading material, which I semi-legally actually.
This term doesn't exist.
I know that. So I scan stuff, put it into PDFs, and put that online, right, for my students to read. Because I discovered that they find the trip to the library much too tiring, and so it's easier than they do. click on something. And okay, as long as this is closed, nobody knows that I'm doing this, so it's okay, right? That's one thing. So I definitely don't want to put that open to the whole wide world. Then there is communication between me and the students in the Moodle system. That's nobody else's business. It's the business between me and the group of people whom I'm teaching. Right? So I don't want to have that online either. Then I have stuff there which is my explanation of some particular issue that we're now discussing. Now that's something which is very rough, which I think is rough, but this is the way things are. This is academia. I don't want that online either, because Maria might read it and she will say, oh, Vincent, come on, you know, you haven't read this, you didn't that. In other words, before I want to put something online and have it accessible to the wide world, I would have to have it checked and referenced and done properly and so on. Now, I cannot do that with all my teaching material. That would just be too much work. So therefore, I don't do that with the teaching material. And I'm not an expert on everything I teach either. Okay, so that's out as well. So what's left of the class? There is the interaction with the students, which I can put on the published material, which is other people's stuff, mostly. It is my own stuff. It's already online anyway, so it's okay. And then there's this other stuff, which I don't want people to see, basically. So if I want to put a class online, I have to be, it's a publication project. I have to think, what is it that I want to do? How should I structure it? And it's a lot of work to get one class online. I've done that once. It's a lot of work. It's like writing a paper or two. It's a different ballgame altogether. So I think this open repository is a very useful thing. We should do that, but we should not expect that that's the norm.
We should not expect
that will be the way classes are run under normal circumstances.
Wouldn't you like to share your opinion, your view on your class with another colleague that gives the same class? Would you like to build a common class? You put something, another colleague put something else, but metadata are there, licenses are there, so no one can copy you, or you cannot copy the other person.
We've been doing that for centuries.
So everybody's acknowledged. I mean, I put something, I did something. I put my material, my educational material, the material I give to my students. And on metadata, there's my name, there are preservation metadata. So what I made will be there forever. Forever. Okay. I didn't mean to be scary, sorry. And then Ileana comes, for example, and she teaches the same class at another university, and she wants to add stuff, she wants to use some of my stuff, and I allow that.
We've been doing that for centuries.
She would not be copying me. She would say, this is the part of Mrs.
We do that in a controlled environment, so I do write things which are for teaching. Right? So people publish textbooks, for example. And of course, they write other stuff, which is for teaching purposes. That's fine, you can do that. But what I'm saying is that you don't want to expect that that's going to be the normal thing that will happen in all classes. That is what
I'm saying. Yes, but we should ask, so further discussion, we should ask students, what is their opinion?
If they want,
everything
is free.
So, no further discussion.
You had a question. Yes, unfortunately, I would be my colleague, I'm a teacher too, but public upper secondary education. And I'd say the reality is not so ideal. These copy matters you mentioned are very critical.
So you are afraid that everybody is going to
steal from you? We try to make corrections to our own guidelines to our students all the time, and this makes us subject to a continuous process of auto-correction, mankind. During the process of education, during the semester, I think, it's difficult to have a final point of our material, of our teaching material. This is crucial, I think.
To have
a final email to find out version of material. That's what my colleague mentioned.
And there's also another program. Maybe you want to listen to the teacher. I don't like whatever it is. You're online to be criticized for what you teach, and then everybody can see your
exactly. That's what I
so mean. In a world, for example, like Greek academia, I don't have any information that any other academia is better than ours in this aspect.
From the most innocent
we have only have in academia, so anybody can tell you, you know, you have this article but not that article, and so there are many countries that don't really get a big picture of this. We love this, we want to share, that's what it is, because we share. But you have to take account that you cannot attack the forces of a rebel swan. You never don't see it. And second, all of this, privacy matters, that when Vincent speaks to his students, he doesn't need to know what he tells to his students. Not only privacy, but could always be such criticism, bad faith criticism.
Okay.
So we restrain, in a way, freedom of teaching. In a way. In every way.
But you can have your material you want. You're not forced to publish all of your material.
No, not.
I think what I said in the beginning is probably true. It's a generational question.
Probably.
When the old guys die out, you'll be able to step online.
But if you keep some material, then isn't it a breach of freedom of information too? If you keep it's not total kind of freedom of information.
If it's for the purpose to secure freedom of teaching,
so they are the woman and
that means
and maybe
side of
interest.
Yeah, what we just wanted to see, and we learned from you, is to see all the aspects of this problem, all of them, if possible. Next, that's next year's
next year.
Okay. Next question.
Sociology of law subject with previous more technical presentations, but this was a very great time because my presentation is connected with doctoral research ongoing, and it's about lifelong learning and its implementation, the implementation of the legal framework in European Union and in Greece, and some limitations and difficulties tackled during this this work that we are going to highly illustrate. In this paper, we're going to outline mainly recent and current European Union and Greek policies about open access, freedom of information, transparency and openness as two general that are part of freedom of information, as previously mentioned. So, we're going to focus on the problem of access to public documents, so in the public sector. In the beginning, I would like to briefly define two fundamental principles, that is openness and transparency. Well, openness has become a core principle.